One way perhaps to get a sense of this is to look at what we mean by space and time, simultaneous change unfolding across geographic space and historical time. This is somewhat like Ed Ayers showed us last night with the dispersion of former slaves after the Civil War throughout different parts of the United States. Anyhow, so I'm going to get this going. Now, what I want you to do, I want you to concentrate very well, and I want you to tell me, or some of you to tell me, what you see. What you see. Now, give you a little bit of an orientation here. This around here is Paris. Here's Marseille. Lyon, about here. Those are the three biggest cities in France at this time. Up here is the region called the Nord, which is the heartland of the Industrial Revolution, or the industrialization of France, and also a very highly productive agrarian region. Bordeaux, this is where the great wine comes from, but of course Burgundy, that's my favorite right there. On your mark, get set. These are rail lines that are being built and coming into being as they cross the French countryside. The red just indicates here, these are the lines or the segments thereof that are new. Seeing much? Well, I could let this run to 2002, but I think that might be pressing it a little bit. But what do you see? What do you see? Anybody?
Especially out of Paris.
Absolutely. From the 1840s, the Minister of Public Works and the École des Ponts et Chaussées, the engineering school of France, really determined that the rail system in France was going to radiate out from Paris. All lines should lead to Paris. All roads lead to Rome. All rail lines lead to Paris. It's very complicated, and I share your hesitancy in trying to suggest a pattern, because actually what I'm trying to help you understand is how complicated it is to get a handle on simultaneous change in space and time. And it's one of the ways to get a handle on it, isn't it, is to sort of stop time. Freeze the frame, stop the movie, let me look at a couple of static maps. So here you have a series of static maps, 1845, 1854, 1876, 1914, and then 1890. One of the things that you will, it was already noticed, I think it was Mr. Pauly, right, that noticed this. You're either an engineer or you're very acute in your observations, but indeed the radiating sort of design of the railways. And if we stopped time and look, we don't find railways going east and west for the most part until the 1870s. So this project to get everything leading to Paris had been achieved. Now, in 1890, about 90% of what would be the French rail network had been established, had been created. So this particular map shows us about 90% of what would be in place by the First World War. Now, once it's stopped, we can see some other patterns. The industrial heartland of France is certainly well served by rail service. But there are other places, notably in the South, where rail service has yet to arrive. Here, also in central Brittany. So there are disparities, regional disparities in the provision of rail service. We could call that, it's a very nice indicator of what I consider to be uneven development.